You're listening to BioTalk with Rich Bendis, the only podcast focused on the biohealth capital region. Each episode, we'll talk to leaders in the industry to break down the biggest topics happening today in biohealth.
Hi, this is Rich Bendis, and I'm the host of BioTalk, and I'm also CEO of Biohealth Innovation. Some good news before we get into the BioTalk with our special guest today. The Biohealth Capital Region has moved up one spot in the Genetic Engineering News BioCluster rankings to number 4. And as the listeners know, we want to be a top 3 by 2023. We're ahead of schedule. So it's exciting to hear that news. And also, one of the people that's helping contribute to that is affiliated with one of our academic partners in the Biohealth Capital Region. And I want to welcome Brian Darmody, who's the Associate Vice President for Corporate Engagement at the University of Maryland in College Park, to BioTalk. Brian, welcome to BioTalk.
Thank you, Rich.
I'd like to get a little background on you before we get into some special things that I know that you want to talk about, with some big events going to be happening at College Park in the near future. But let's give the listeners a little background and history about Brian Darmody and how long you've been at the University of Maryland in College Park.
So first of all, I'm not a bioscientist, but I have been interested in technology commercialization, how to leverage our assets here in the Baltimore-Washington region. Quickly, my background, I worked in Congress actually for Gladys Spellman a few years ago and worked for a delegate in Annapolis, but then worked for the Healthcare Financing Administration when there was a HICFA embedded in Social Security at the time in Baltimore in the Office of Attorney Advisor while going to law school at night. Then I came to the University of Maryland in the legal office, and that was right at the time the Bayh-Dole Act passed. And we had just built an incubator on campus, and I remember
What year was this?
That was in the early 80s. I think the Bayh-Dole Act passed in 1981. We had recruited a faculty member from Rutgers University who had a company that he had started. In 1981, that was pretty unusual, right? But we had built this incubator, and I remember being in the legal office, and the legal folks said, "Oh, Brian, that company can't come in because it's associated with a faculty member. He has a financial interest, and that's forbidden by the state ethics law." And I said, And I thought, that's rather counterintuitive. You would think we would want to support faculty startups and allow that company to come into the incubator. But they just said, not possible. It violates the state ethics law. At the time, I started, because of my background in lobbying on the Hill and in Annapolis, I started moving into the role of being a lobbyist. And one of the first things I took on was, we should change the state ethics law, at least for faculty members who are public employees subject to the public ethics law. But clearly, if the state wanted to develop its technology-based economy, it needed to reform the state ethics law. So I went down there and the first year, and I was laughed out of the hearing room because they said, there's no reason to change the ethics laws. But I then had an insight, actually working in Montgomery County, had started a business support group for higher ed. So I recruited some of those folks down and developed them to help me come down and lobby the change in the law, which then passed unanimously. And I think that's been a model for how an appropriate state ethics law can be reformed, still allow faculty to be involved with tech transfer, but having transparency and having approvals at higher levels.
Is that revised law still in existence in the format that was changed over 30 years ago?
Yes. And I think some other states have used it. And I think later on we'll talk about federal labs and perhaps, you know, that model could
some
be used for federal labs.
Some other changes that need to happen.
Yes.
Right. Great. So that's a brief introduction, but what do you actually do every day at the University of Maryland, Brian?
I had been the Associate Vice President for Research Economic Development. So now I'm involved in the President's Office in Corporate Engagement. So my job is to go out and develop partnerships, typically with the private sector, but sometimes it involves federal agencies given our location, and develop either philanthropic or research partnerships working with the team at the University of Maryland. We have a division of research and we have a division of university relations, both of whom have resources in that area. Uniquely, I try to develop partnerships with both because sometimes corporations want to develop a research relationship that can lead to philanthropy. And so I am agnostic to that. I just want a relationship with the private sector.
I know you have a love for technology-based economic development, which I now refer to as innovation-based economic development. But you've done many other things in Maryland related to trying to enhance the ecosystem with new public policies or creation of new entities. So what else have you been involved with within the state of Maryland that's helped advance where we are in economic development through technology these days?
One of the insights I had when I was a lobbyist was we had our tech transfer offices, but because they were buried deep within the bureaucracy of a university, maybe they weren't getting enough attention and funding. And knowing how entities are funded, I thought to myself, it'd be nice if we, the state of Maryland, had a technology intermediary. Sort of at the time we had MEDCO, the Maryland Economic Development Corporation, which was focused on real estate. I essentially borrowed that statute and said, whoever said real estate, inserted technology and created some legislation with the help of some friends in the General Assembly that eventually created what's now known as TEDCO. But the whole idea was that entity could get some funding from the state, and that entity could then help fund tech transfer activities at the universities and help build innovation-based economic development.
And that was over 20 years ago, and TEDCO is one of the most important contributors to early stage technology in the state today. We had George Davis on BioTalk a couple months ago talking about what TEDCO does, but I guess without some of the vision of early leaders within the state, it wouldn't be here today.
Yeah, I mean, it's changed a lot, and thanks to, you know, governors, a number of administrations have supported TEDCO, and so I think it's been a great model for what states can do, you know, across the nation.
And in addition to what you've been doing here within the state of Maryland, you've been an activist, I would say, nationally related to public policy and groups who are involved with commercialization, tech transfer, and economic development activities where a university can play a role.
Yes. So I'm the past president of the Association of University Research Parks. So when I was president, this was 10 years ago, we developed some policy papers for technology-led economic development using federal resources. At the time, of course, and even now, there's not a lot of new money that exists for technology-based development. But our ideas were focused on increasing the amount of permission for various technology development. I'll give you one quick example. In many federal grants, a principal investigator, i.e. the researcher, can't charge for cost of patents under OMB accounting rules, which seems a little odd that maybe if we want to incentivize more tech transfer, allowing a principal investigator, not requiring, but allowing a principal investigator to charge his or her grant patent costs, that may develop more technologies. I mean, that's one. There's another complicated IRS rule about doing research in tax-exempt bond finance facilities, and it doesn't allow universities to have flexible IP policies. That was another kind of reform that we've been seeking, and hopefully at some point Congress will see our way and help develop a more flexible way that universities can engage with the private sector and lead to more companies and more innovation.
And I remember interacting with you years ago when you were the president of AURP with the other alphabet soup organizations. We have SSTI, State Science and Technology Institute, of which Britt Kerwin, who was the president and chancellor for the University System of Maryland, served on that board for several years.
So, and my boss.
And your boss at
for
that
many
time.
Years.
And then there's AUTM, Association for University Technology Managers. And then there was the National Association of Seed and Venture Funds. And I know that you were very active with AURP of interacting with these other groups with their constituencies to try to advance technology-based economic development in the nation.
Yes. And another group is INBA, International Business Incubation Association, which I was just at their conference in Detroit, and they are looking at how universities can lead to economic development and build innovation districts in economically distressed areas. And so I spoke about some things we're doing in Maryland, and there are people from across the country. And I think Detroit is one of those turnaround cities and turnaround examples using some technology to help rebuild the urban core.
But one that you're still intimately involved with every day is the Association for University Research Parks. And I understand that they may be coming to Maryland.
Not only may they definitely are. So a couple years ago, I put in a bid to host this at the University of Maryland because we have a brand new hotel at the University of Maryland right at our front gate. It's a gorgeous conference hotel. And I knew that was coming. So I said, well, let's put in, Brian, put in a bid and we'll see if we get it there. So the Association of University Research Parks brings together research park directors from around the world, but mostly from the United States, people like this from Stanford Research Park, which was the first research park in the country, actually the world. So the Stanford Research Park was created in the late 1950s. And that model was emulated by universities around the United States, and increasingly countries around the world adopted that probably most in the greatest way is China. If you've been to China, you'll see there are whole science cities based around research parks. Anyway, the association brings together research park directors, but also venture capitalists, people that are interested in technology development, as well as facilities people. So I think this conference is unique in that it brings together the people that build the facilities where tech commercialization can happen, as well as the people that have the inventions. And you need both of them, quite frankly, to build a robust ecosystem. So the main part of the conference will take place at the University of Maryland. And a team has put this together. Former Howard County executive Ken Ullman is part of the University of Maryland team. He's been quite instrumental in bringing a lot of companies to the College Park area. And former U.S. Commerce Assistant Secretary and EDA Executive Julie Lenzer is part of the team from the, and she now works at the University of Maryland, heads up all of our tech commercialization activities, and is Chief Innovation Officer. So collectively, the three of us have put together a conference that's not just going to focus on what we're doing at College Park, but really about all the resources in the Baltimore-Washington corridor.
And the biohealth capital region.
The biohealth capital, or as I call it, the bio-DMV, is another way of explaining that this area has a lot of technology. And so we are going to have a panel with research parks from Johns Hopkins, University of Maryland, Baltimore County, University of Maryland Biopark, and Montgomery College, which is right near where we are, on a panel sort of discussing each of their strengths and how they develop the Baltimore-Washington ecosystem. And the AURP International Conference people are saying, Brian, nobody else has ever done this. You know, usually it's one research park and they are not bringing in others. So I think given the amount of resources we have in the area, that was our strategy of let's showcase the whole area.
I know in attracting national meetings like this, it doesn't happen cavalierly. You basically have to make a financial commitment to the association to be able to attract that. So that meant that you had your development hat on, raising money to help fund AURP to come to College Park. Is that correct?
Yes, yes. We had to get sponsors, and I will say we were very successful. We have sponsors from most of those universities I mentioned, as well as the Maryland Department of Commerce. We mentioned TEDCO. We mentioned Medco, Montgomery County Economic Development Corporation, and a number of private sector sponsors, including Whiting Turner, HDR, Perkins Will, and people from the facility side, as well as the technology development side.
Well, congrats on that. I know it's heavy lifting, putting your hand out to ask for that money all the time, but it's a worthy cause to be able to showcase what's going on in this region, and especially the exciting development that's going on in College Park right now.
Yeah, so we have the nation's first WeWork ever at a university. The co-working company has established its co-working space immediately behind the garage at the University of Maryland. So I think, and I believe that's going to open November 1st. So it's right around the time or right after the conference, it will have its official opening. So that's going to be the kind of leveraging assets. And at the rear of the hotel, we have about, I think, 30,000 square feet of space where companies like Capital One, we have a number of cybersecurity companies are coming in there. So that hotel is not just a conference hotel, it's really an innovation hotel. And it's a way of leveraging assets to bring together companies and having all those resources, you know, a hotel where you can stay at, the restaurants, the bar, the coffee shop, all of that is in one space. Plus you have 37,000 highly educated and highly motivated potential employees called students. And so I think you're going to see a lot of companies want to locate in areas like at College Park, but this is going on at Johns Hopkins and across Maryland, but also across the country, is the war for talent. It's no longer can corporations, whether you're a bio company or a tech company, you can't expect to go to the career fair once a year and recruit those really top students. I think what you're going to see is companies developing outposts at universities for both a technology development, but also a human capital development.
As you know, a lot of our listeners are very focused on the biohealth industry. And AURP does not focus just on biohealth. It focuses on anything related to the development of research around a university and their park. But what would be of interest for our listeners that are going to be occurring at your conference?
You're exactly right, Rich. But this conference, given the set of resources we have here, we do have some specific things I think that would be of interest to the biohealth community. On Monday, October 22nd, we will be part of the group attending the groundbreaking for the Viva White Oak Project. And the Viva White Oak Project is adjacent to the FDA headquarters. And that is going to be a science and tech and a hotel and other kinds of project that will be adjacent to the FDA headquarters and also the new $300 million Seventh-day Adventist Hospital. As you know, all drugs and devices must go, there is a road from across the country, and that road goes through White Oak, because if you want to have a drug or device approved by the federal government, it has to go through the FDA in White Oak. So there's 8,000 FDA employees there, a lot of them researchers. So we're going to be there, part of the Viva White Oak Project, and I believe, I think the FDA commissioner is scheduled to be there.
Yeah, I just saw today Barbara Mikulski has agreed to come and speak. So the invitation list is growing, and I'm sure Jonathan Jen with Perconti, who has been, this has been a labor of his life for the last decade, is going to be pleased that you mentioned this on BioTalk today.
Well, and they are also sponsors of AURP.
So what else might there be related to biohealth that the listeners would be interested in?
So on Thursday, we're going to have the Thursday of the October 24th, we're going to have a session talking about corporate university partnerships, including Jared Borkat, who was formerly with MedImmune, now with Emergent BioSolutions. And we have technology reps from Northrop Grumman, Lockheed Martin, and Capital One, really talking about how can we collectively develop more corporate university partnerships in a physical way, because almost all of those corporations have physical locations at the University of Maryland or other universities across the country. Later on that day, we're going to have a session on the National Institute for Innovation in Manufacturing Biopharmaceuticals, more better known as NIMBLE, which is one of the six manufacturing institutes. There are these national manufacturing institutes. This one uniquely is managed by NIST here in Gaithersburg, the National Institutes for Standards and Technologies, and it's focused on developing new pathways, new regulatory, new technologies for manufacturing biopharmaceuticals, which is one of the country's, you know, leading areas. And it's one that we as a country need to maintain our preeminence in. And so this institute's headquartered at University of Delaware, but the FDA, Johns Hopkins, University of Maryland College Park, as well as University of Maryland Baltimore, NCI, and the state of Maryland are all major partners in this. So this is a national consortium, but it has major presence in both Delaware and Maryland. And we're going to be talking about how we can develop more pathways and develop that sector and make sure it maintain its preeminence.
Well, it sounds like you've got a pretty exciting lineup for the AURP conference, which is going to be at College Park, October 22nd to 26th, if I have my dates correct.
That is correct.
But one of the topics that I know that will be discussed there is something new that's emerging in the federal government, which is federal opportunity zones. Let's talk a little bit about your opinion and direction you think those federal opportunity zones will go and the opportunities they create for universities or other people within the technology ecosystems.
As you said, there is this new federal investment tool that came from last year's Tax Reform Act. And basically, states across the country the governors of those states early this spring identified 25% of low-income census tracts in each state's jurisdiction that were designated federal opportunity zones. And basically, this allows investors, if you invest in infrastructure or a company that's located in one of these opportunity zones, the investor can eliminate any capital gains on their investment as long as it's held for more than 10 years. There's many complications. We don't have time to go into this podcast, but I think the interesting thing is I looked at the federal opportunity zones identified in the state of Maryland, and a number of them are around universities. As a matter of fact, we're the AURP conference, the hotel at the University of Maryland, and the WeWork space, as well as the space around in our Discovery District, is a federal opportunity zone. That's true also at Johns Hopkins, adjacent to the Fast Forward space, the UMB Biopark, Morgan State University, a HBCU, historically black college, a university in Baltimore, is a federal opportunity zone. Montgomery College here in Gaithersburg is an opportunity zone. Frostburg in Western Maryland, part of Salisbury on the Eastern Shore, are all opportunity zones. So this could be a pretty transformative way to bring capital, needed capital, to these areas to fund infrastructure and to fund potentially companies. Now, the downside is the regs aren't out yet. And I'm not an investor. I've talked to some people who are setting up these federal opportunity funds, and they are somewhat concerned that you have to deploy your capital very, very quickly. So if you recall during the stimulus, we had to have shovel-ready projects. I think we need investment-ready projects. So I don't know exactly what the timeline is going to be, but it'll come out in these federal regulations. So one downside might be investors would have to invest so quickly. And you know, Rich, you're an investor. You can't make a decision in a week. It requires a lot of due diligence. And so hopefully the regs will develop such that investors will have some time, or maybe even Congress might tweak this. I don't know. But I think it is a great opportunity for the state to look at bringing needed capital, whether it's bio or whether it's, other kinds of technology.
So I guess what would your recommendation be to the listeners who may be interested in this in order to be proactive so that you can be investment ready when this does materialize?
So there's an organization called CDFA, the Community Development Financing Association. They have probably the best up-to-date information, I think, on kind of how these opportunity zones are going to work. It's not necessarily public, but I hear some investors are putting together some early funds. A couple of states, I read something on the CDFA website, a couple of states have gotten ahead of this and are trying to make sure their state, either they are developing other incentives from the state's perspective to get these opportunity zones kicked off. So I think being watchful on the web, and when the federal regs come out, which I think probably is supposedly in the next 10 days, I think you're going to see a lot more information and probably some announcements of some funds being created. Obviously, the regs aren't out, so no funds are yet certified, but I think you're going to see that very quickly.
We're speaking with Brian Darmody, the Associate Vice President for Corporate Engagement at the University of Maryland. And we were just on a discussion about a new federal program, and I want to stay on the federal theme for a little bit. The federal government has 59 labs within the state of Maryland, which is more than any other state in the United States. And we have not been able to realize the greatest return on investment on all of those assets that are here. And I think that those labs generate over $12 billion of annual investment in federal funds that comes into the state of Maryland annually. I know you have some strong feelings about the way we can be more proactive in the utilization of those resources and assets we have, and you've been collaborating with the Life Science Advisory Board on some of the recommendations that could be made to generate greater returns for us as taxpayers on all these federal assets in Maryland. So I'd like to get some comments from you related to this federal environment in Maryland. So you're talking about a national intermediary.
Yes. And so like a national federal technology intermediary. And there are some examples of this, something called the Scoop Jackson Foundation or Jackson Foundation.
Henry Jackson,
that was the name of the senator from the state of Washington. Congress chartered this foundation under federal law, but it said it had to be created in the state of Maryland. And it has gone to be a fairly robust nonprofit association based in Maryland using federal tax dollars, but it has much more flexibility than other entities. And why not take that same kind of a model and again, give it, create it and it be a resource for tech transfer offices so that we're not always finding ways not to commercialize technologies. Universities have things called research foundations, and they are affiliated flexible organizations. University of Virginia has a Virginia Patents Foundation. Again, these entities were created by universities as workaround entities. Take that model and let's apply it to federal agencies. Not that this would be a supervisory entity for a tech transfer office, but really a tool that would allow more business-like transactions in the business of commercialization of all these great inventions that sometimes are lying inside of federal agencies. And as you know, it's not just the technology, it requires investors, it requires a whole complicated web of relationships that maybe a tech commercialization entity could aggregate rather than just trying to do it through the federal system.
It's almost like taking a biohealth innovation and making it a national model where it's private sector driven to understand the market needs, but has the nimbleness to be able to respond quickly around innovation and commercialization, which does not really occur regularly within the federal environment.
Right. And I mean, and it's not the fault of the tech transfer offices necessarily. They just don't have the flexibility, and they're just one piece of the larger ecosystem that needs to take place. And ideally, this could happen in, you know, biohealth. It could happen in IT. It could happen
cybersecurity,
in
cybersecurity. Yeah, almost any technical or industry area. And I think that also you're passionate about these programs and help take the lead to respond for the state of Maryland, for the Life Science Board, to the request for information that NIST put out a couple months ago looking for ways to increase return on investment on the $150 billion of annual funds that go into our federal labs and agencies around research.
Yes, I was very thrilled to see that NIST had taken this leadership role on the RFI return on investment program, looking at how they can increase the economic impact of federal research, whether it's deployed at universities, in businesses, or in federal labs. And I'm very much looking forward to the results of that. And we are going to have the director of NIST at my AURP conference. So yet another reason why someone would want to get involved. And hopefully Dr. Copan will be able to update folks on where they are in terms of their looking at the return on investment.
So you mentioned the conference again. Let's remind the listeners that the Association of University Research Parks is having an international meeting that will be at College Park, University of Maryland, October 22nd to the 26th. Now, the listeners are probably saying, can I participate? Can I attend? Or is this a closed meeting only for members of AURP?
No, this is very much an open meeting. You can go to AURP.net and the full program is listed there. And you can see everything that we're doing and all the different conferences. And as you mentioned, it is international. So we are going to have a number of international guests who are learning from U.S. But we want round trip kind of partnerships. We just don't want folks coming this way. So you're going to hear some initiatives on international research parks conferences. So even if you're just thinking about developing an innovation district or a research park, because you know we make this conference to be much broader than just research parks. It's really about the collective vision of infrastructure for facilities with technology and making sure you have supportive policies at the local level, but also leadership. And our Secretary of Commerce, Mike Gill, is going to be there to give a welcome. And I'm sure it will be quite a performance.
Brian, I've enjoyed this conversation. I think it's been very educational and a lot of good information we've imparted to our listeners. Any last words that you have, since this is your first and maybe last opportunity with an open mic on BioTalk?
Well, I just want to appreciate, thank you, Rich, for your leadership with BHI. I've watched you grow this. As you mentioned, you and I met on the road many, many years ago, and I know you're not a native Marylander. I'm a native Marylander, but I very much appreciate what you've done, because I've seen many people try to pull different groups together, but you succeeded, and I'm very proud of what BHI does, and not only just in Maryland, but in the BioHealth Capital Region.
Thank you much for those kind words. Look forward to the conference. Hope to come up and be able to break some bread with you up there and visit some of my old friends from around the country and internationally. I want to thank Brian Darmody, the Associate Vice President for Corporate Engagement at the University of Maryland, for appearing on BioTalk. We hope maybe a year from now we can come back and talk about some of the new policies that you've been able to create that will help stimulate us at the federal level. Brian, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to BioTalk with Rich Bendis.